Geehrte Damen und Herren, liebe Teilnehmende, herzlich willkommen zurück zum University Future Festival. Wir sind heute hier mit dem Conference Day und versammeln nationale und internationale Speakerinnen und Speaker zur Zukunft der digitalen Hochschulbildung. Wir haben ihn gerade schon einmal kurz angekündigt, jetzt aber auch in der langen Fassung. Der nächste Keynote Speaker ist außerordentlicher Professor für Instructional Technologies im Fachbereich Equity Leadership Studies und Instructional Technologies der San Francisco State University. Zu seinen Interessens- und Forschungsschwerpunkten gehören soziale Interaktion beim Online-Lernen, die Implementierung des Flipped Classroom sowie die Entwicklung der Instruktionsdesign-Theorie für hybrid-flexible Lernumgebungen. An der SFSU leistete er Pionierarbeit bei der Entwicklung und Evaluierung des HyFlex-Kursentwurfsmodells für Blended-Learning-Umgebungen und entwickelte einen studentengesteuerten hybriden Ansatz zur Verbesserung des studentischen Lernens. Also hier auch wieder ganz klar der Fokus auf die Studierenden. Er spricht heute über hybrid-flexible Learning Environments, supporting student success. Please give a warm hand to Professor Brian Biddy. The floor is yours.
All right. Thank you. Hope you can hear me okay. Thank you for the invitation to speak to you today. I always appreciate the opportunity to share what I've been doing and what we've been doing with hundreds, if not thousands, of people around the world, especially these days, using hybrid flexible or high flex learning environments to support our students in their successful adventures in learning. So that's kind of what we're all about. So I'm going to talk to you for just a brief time today, maybe 20 minutes, and there will be opportunity for Q&A afterwards. So if you have questions, please don't hesitate to put those into the kind of the question queue, and we'll get to as many as we possibly can. Normally I take at least an hour, hour and a half to talk about this with larger groups because there are always lots of questions. And so there will be questions afterwards. If you're wanting to send me an email with questions, I'm happy to also respond to those as we go. There are also some documents in the uploaded to the presentation site, the presentation plus a couple of supporting documents that might help you as well. So I look forward to sharing these ideas with you and hearing the questions you have as well. Now I just have to figure out how to make it go. Great. So I'm Dr. Biddy, as Nadia said. Thank you very much for that introduction. I'm a professor at San Francisco State, and I've been there for about 17 years now. Up until this last spring, I was an administrator for 8 years, overseeing all of our academic technology functions and working a lot in the IT area, but also very involved in the support of faculty using technology to teach various ways. Before that, I was department chair and professor, and that's when I was actually developing HyFlex and teaching it in my own classes and starting to talk about it and write about it, etc. But I also have a background in e-learning design, training in corporate industries, also in the U.S. Navy in the technical training area. My background's in engineering in the very first place, so I have a very eclectic background. And I've been involved in this field for a long time, probably 30 or 35 years if I go back to my nuclear power experience. So, and there's a book out that you can refer to if you want a lot more details about that. No, it'll be on the slides a couple of places. So today there's really only like four or five things I think I can get to in 20 minutes. I want to talk briefly about the need to support all of our students who need education and how HyFlex can be part of the solution to that. And then I'll talk a little bit about specifically what we do in HyFlex, and especially, you know, kind of comparing what we've done before and what we're doing now and what's happening in the field now, and probably then what's going to be happening forward, maybe some forward-looking ideas on how we can actually improve what we're doing, not necessarily get back to normal as we've been talking about, but looking for a new path forward that's going to be even better than before. So clearly, education is a complex space. It's a complex system, and it's full of what we call wicked problems, problems that are resistant to resolution. And providing equitable access to high quality instruction is one of those problems. Just the whole idea of equity and social justice, it's a core a part of what San Francisco State stands for many, many years, around supporting all of our students and supporting students, especially those who have historically poor access to education and, you know, lack of opportunity in different ways. And yet we find that even today, we still have issues around access, and it's not just access in the classroom or access online. It's access all across the board, and not for all of our students, but for many of our students, and it varies based on their particular situations. And your institutions are probably experiencing many of the similar aspects of that. So how do we get there from where we are now? How do we provide them equitable access, and you know, without just completely replacing our system? Because that's just not going to happen. How do we change our system? How do we shift it towards one that's being able to provide better and more equitable access for all of our students, all of those who want to learn and are capable of learning? I worked on a white paper this summer with colleagues from Canada, and we had to come up with a definition of equity in education. And when I looked on our campus has struggled to find a definition of equity in education or equity in social justice even. But I came up with this definition that's kind of a working definition. So students are able to achieve equal learning outcomes, right? Supported by all the aspects of the system. They receive the support they need. This could be financial support, social support, academic support, et cetera, to succeed. And that prepares them for their lifelong success. And then we also want to make sure that they have access, like they can get to appropriate and effective learning opportunities, right? So this is the instruction, the courses, the resources, the interactions, the evaluations, the assessments, all those things that we need to support a quality educational process. In 2005, we had a challenge in our program. We had declining enrollments. This was a graduate program. And our department chair suggested that we turn our program into an online program because that's what a lot of universities were doing. But we did not have online students. We did not have online teachers. None of us had taught fully online. And our students were all regionally located. So it didn't seem to make a lot of sense to us as a faculty. So I suggested that perhaps we could find some sort of a compromise solution. Can we provide access to our face-to-face courses to our online students or our local students who wanted to participate online? And so that was the start of HyFlex. What we found out very quickly was that not only did it serve students who couldn't come there because it was too far or they had a time conflict, but it also served students who felt like they would learn better in that particular situation as an online student asynchronously at that point. And so we found that there were a lot of other benefits we had, not just maintaining enrollment, but also providing a better environment for students and a more capable environment, essentially a HyFlex course. When you boil it down, is essentially it's a face-to-face course and an online course. It's the same course with multiple participation modes, right? EDUCAUSE did a nice little graphic a number of years ago. I like to show this. It's just basically showing that when I would teach a HyFlex course starting out, I would meet my class face-to-face. And when I first started this, I said, hey, guess what? You can actually participate in this course as an online student. If you can't be here or don't want to be here, there's a fully aligned online path you do, and here's how you do that in the learning management system. And so basically the challenge was to design one course that students then could provide or could participate in multiple modes. When I started, it was a simple online course or the classroom course they were used to. We did come up with a definition for this. We were working on an online education policy a number of years ago, more than a decade ago. And HyFlex was something that was starting to happen more on our campus. And our instructional design team was influencing the policy direction for the Senate in this area. And so they really supported this. Essentially, we came up with just a simple definition, and this is what works for us today. Students can choose, that's the flexibility part, to attend class either face-to-face, you know, a regular classroom environment, or in an online environment. And sometimes that's synchronously, sometimes it's asynchronously, sometimes it's either or perhaps even both. It kind of depends upon the way the faculty has designed the course and the resources and the technologies we have set up to support that. When we started, it was just asynchronous. And then we added the synchronous capability as the web conferencing tools became more easily accessible to us on campus. From the very beginning, we wanted to fundamentally kind of align this to principles, right? And so we have these values of alternative paths and equivalent learning outcomes and being able to reuse, essentially creating a single learning community out of multiple modes, and also a value of accessibility. And so we have these simple principle statements that you can see here on the screen. It's important that for it to be a HyFlex course, it has to have alternatives for students. And in my mind, and the way we do it on our campus, and most people who do HyFlex, at least in pre-COVID days, that we want students to be able to make that choice on a session by session or class by class basis. Are you in class or are you online? If you're online, here's what you're going to do. If you're in classes, here's what you're going to do. Both of those paths have to lead to equivalent learning outcomes. We can't design a course that provides options among participation, but one of those options doesn't lead to the same learning outcomes, at least the opportunity for that. Not all students succeed in all paths, just like they don't today. But what we have to do is make sure that the design supports students who are able to interact and are willing to engage to reach those learning outcomes, no matter which path they choose or which combination of paths they may choose. We also want to make sure that we are connecting our online and our face-to-face classrooms through the reuse of materials. And so when I create a course, I create it for an online version, the online asynchronous, and I use all those materials in a face-to-face class as well. When I do online discussions with my students, those are also discussions sometimes required for the face-to-face students, but even if they're not required, all those discussions are available for face-to-face students. And so they have the opportunity to continue the conversations we may have in class. I also like to record what goes on in the class, especially the interactive discussions, and allow those to be used as online resources, learning resources for the online students. It's not a perfect resource, but a lot of times it adds a lot of additional content that's just not available if you're not there live in class. And the last thing is accessibility. And this is where kind of the equitable access really is important, is that we want to make sure that all of our students have access to the alternative paths, at least one online path, as well as the face-to-face class. Now, not every student's going to have access to a classroom, especially if they're coming from very far away, or maybe they are really a distant student who's able to now take a class that's offered face-to-face because there's an online participation option. But when they do are able to make choices like that, we have to be able to support them. One of the challenges here is it's also obviously the accessibility of the content, right? So screen readers have to be able to use the content, captions on videos, things like that. But students who are local but don't have access to a legitimate network or bandwidth to work from home, like we're really finding out now in the last 6 months or so, it's on us, I think, if we're going to design this path, that we provide all the supports we possibly can so that they can participate those ways as well. In a class like I teach a lot of graduate seminar courses. I typically have around half, maybe a little more than half, the students participating in class. And then, if I have synchronous online, many of the online students will do it synchronously because they like the engagement, the dynamic nature of that. And then some of them do it asynchronous. And then this changes. Usually there's a couple of people who switch back and forth every week. I often have probably half the class always in the classroom, and another half the class, or another, maybe 30% of the class always online, and then there's that 20% who are shifting back and forth, typically based on their schedules. When I was tracking this, I would essentially over a couple of semesters, 60% in class, 30% online, and 10% just not showing up somewhere. There was always that 10%. We always talk about that 10%. Well, they're still here in HyFlex too. I did survey them. Especially the first couple of years I was doing this, I want to make sure that they were finding some success and they were, it was meeting their perceived needs as well as their learning needs. So I tracked grades as well. No difference based on their participation. Sort of satisfaction. I have like 79% of them were strongly agree that I learned as much as I expected. That helped me feel like I wasn't giving them a weaker alternative by giving them choices. And I asked them, what would you prefer? And 86%. Said either agree or strongly agree to a statement, I prefer to choose the blend, as opposed to having the faculty choose the blend. We know blended learning is a pretty powerful form of instructional format to use, but in almost every case, it's under the control of the instructor as opposed to under the control of the student. And there's some good reasons for that. I mean, you can pick the best things in the classroom and the best things online, but the problem is when we choosing the best things for the classroom, not all of our students can participate in the classroom or are able to participate like ideally or as designed in the classroom. Sometimes things are just going on that prevents them from adequately participating. Same thing in the online environment. And so what my goal is with HyFlex is to design great solutions in both paths, allow students to make those choices because only they know what's the best fit for them in that particular situation. When I talk with faculty, questions come up, how do we build this? How can you possibly build two or three versions of a course and expect me to do three or four of these every term if I'm in a teaching university? Well, the answer is, well, clearly you can't build three versions of a course. So our design cycle is once we've made a choice to do HyFlex, that's a really important choice. If there's not a good need to be able to support different formats, different students participate in different ways, then it's a lot easier just to focus on a single mode course, a unimode course like a face-to-face class or an online synchronous or an online asynchronous. But I think if you look critically at any one of those courses, there's always a need for some students to have some flexibility in how they're participating if they're going to be getting adequate access and the support for learning like we would provide students in kind of the design mode. So once that decision is made, now we kind of go and say, let's look at the content, let's look at the assessments, look at the engagement approaches, and then let's look at how do we actually implement that, and then we communicate that out. So we start with an excellent online course. That is the presumption that a faculty who wants to teach this way is starting. You're not building a course from scratch usually. Now, you might be building a course from scratch the first time you teach it. If so, you don't have anything to build from, but you also don't have anything to kind of wish you could just teach that way again. So you build it, I encourage people to build it as a fully online course, asynchronous online course by design, because then you have all of the kind of the challenging things are the interaction, the engagement, the assessment for the online environment. You can use all those same approaches or many of those same approaches or variations of those approaches with the same resource set in a face-to-face classroom. And if you can do it in a face-to-face classroom, then it's almost probably 90 or 95% kind of made up numbers. It directly translates to a synchronous session, right? Where you're recording or you're allowing people to participate through video and audio, you know, like we've been living our lives the last 6 to 8 months. So for each piece of this then, so we talk about student learning outcomes. And this is part of the decisioning process, whether or not HyFlex fits. Can student learning outcomes be met well online as well as face-to-face? And sometimes the answer is no. And if the answer is no, then we have to decide, well, is that for the entire course? Or is it maybe just a couple of different outcomes? Like maybe it's an art class and they have to use some, a kiln for ceramics. Or maybe it's some sort of a ensemble music situation where they have to be able to play together in the same room at the same time. And if that can't happen, that's really hard to do online. It may be next to impossible. So that's the kind of situation where there may be some outcomes, and maybe it's for the majority of a course, which means you would not design this for HyFlex. Okay. Science lab courses, sometimes the actual manipulation of the lab equipment has to be done in the lab environment. In that case, well, perhaps at least for the lab component, they have to be on campus, but maybe the rest of it can be where they have some choice and doing it for HyFlex. So we look at outcomes, then we talk about the instructional content. That's usually the easiest thing for most faculty, especially as most of our content has been digitized for us, through the libraries and things like that, or it's more and more common at least. And we talk about assessment. How do we assess in the classroom and how are we gonna assess online? So that can be a challenging decision or development aspect too. Oftentimes we have to think about shifting forms of assessment to better fit all of those students. I'd like to try to keep one form of assessment for all the students. So I typically move things towards the online environment, or at least the out of class environment. And then the engagement piece. The engagement piece is really challenging because this is where the faculty have to really kind of shift their workload. You can't just have an online course and treat those students like you are meeting them once a week, right? You check in on Tuesday at 3 o'clock, and then you don't check in again until Tuesday at 3 o'clock. Doesn't work for an online course, right? It has to be engaging. So faculty have to be able to work into their schedule time for engaging with those online students. That's one of the big challenges. So design and the implementation. Now, what's happening with COVID-19, obviously? Well, our classrooms are totally changed. Right now, many of us are not allowed in our classrooms. Those of us who are usually have restricted numbers of students, and what we can do in the classroom with those students has been restricted as well, okay? And in the future, and actually right now, even when students are in class, there's a good likelihood that some of them will be out of class for up to 2 or 3 weeks at a time as they get exposed to COVID-19 or other kinds of situations. This is not going to go away. I would hope that we would be able to manage COVID, but there will be other things. And regionally located, we have fires every year. We close our campus for smoke. We have the threat of earthquakes and transit strikes, all those things. So there's always a need for us to be able to keep learning, even if we don't have access to the classroom. So we need to be able to build this instructional continuity in here. And so that's one of the things that we're looking for. And that's one of the things that HyFlex gives us. Now, we have a debate on our campus about online. Should it be asynchronous or synchronous? Because what we see is that when we are all doing synchronous teaching, we are preventing some of our students from having good access because they don't have good bandwidth, or they don't have a place at home where they can work well. And so they don't come to class, they don't show up. And so they're missing the opportunity to learn. Same thing in an asynchronous class. Not all the students who will arrange, if we push them all to an asynchronous class, some students learn very poorly there. And we actually see that there, our achievement gap between our underrepresented minorities in the classroom, we have a certain gap, maybe 5 or 10%. Well, that gap is sometimes double in online courses. We think it's due to the relationship, the weaker relationships and the value of those relationships with a lot of people. And so my argument is that the face-to-face classroom is not accessible to everyone. The online synchronous classroom is not accessible to everyone. The online asynchronous classroom is not accessible to everyone for different reasons. And so if we can offer multiple modes, especially if you can get all three of these modes, you're more likely to provide access to more of the students who want to have access to it. And so that's my big pitch for moving forward is that adding multiple formats will only allow us to increase access. We have to do it well, though. We make strategic decisions to do it. We resource it well. We provide faculty the training and support. We provide students the training and support they need to succeed. And then we can basically build kind of a new version of the environment. That's my 20 minutes, roughly. We're going to have some questions here. And once again, I said there's a book out. It's an open access book. We released last October, and it's got lots of references to other works. It's got case studies from other universities around the world, and it's got some research summaries too. There's been some nice dissertations and other kinds of research done on the application of HyPLEX. I don't hear you, Nadia. It could just be my audio.
Okay. Does it work now? Okay. Perfect. Now, thanks a lot again for your insightful talk, Professor Biddy. And I already saw that we have some questions that were popping up during your keynote speech. The first one is by Jürgen Schiffer. How big were the shares of students who took the digital or the local lecture?
Yes, so for classes, I think it depends a lot on the level of students and their engagement in the course. What we have found is that the students at the higher levels in their major courses or graduate courses, more of them tended to come to class live if they were locally, if they were regionally located, because they saw that the interaction was very valuable and they really were invested in learning. And so in those cases, we would find typically 50 to maybe 70 or 80% of the students in classes and the rest doing it online, usually because they couldn't make it to class. Now, when we would go down to the lower levels of undergraduate education, especially in courses that we would call general education, where they're required to take it just as part of the general degree, not the specific degree, then we find that most of those students were actually choosing more for the online option, not coming to class. And it had probably had to do with their commitment to the learning process and the engagement, the immediate personal engagement they were willing to provide to that and care about learning. So in that case, it's specifically more important, I think, for the design of the online environment to not allow those students an easier, kind of more convenient path away from the classroom. So if, as long as you build an interactive, asynchronous online course, those students can still be challenged to learn and can still meet those kind of complex learning outcomes. But that was typically the participation path. As a matter of fact, we had a course, we had 1,200 students in a course, a very large course in the business area. And we put that course in a lecture hall that sat 150 people, because we would get about 135 students, 10% of the class, coming to class. They're all required to do it. Most of them were not majors in this area. And then the other ones just did it as an asynchronous course. So that's what we saw. There was a pretty big shift there as we depended upon how closely the students felt engaged with the content, with the faculty, and with the class itself.
Thank you. The next question is quite a practical one by Thomas Bröker. He asks, what environment do you use to make student outcomes available to everyone? All LMS I know have a hierarchical idea of communication and collaboration. Do you use another type of collaborative platform?
We typically, I start with the LMS because those are the tools that are supported by the university. And you're right, they do have you know, they have their kind of their biases built into them, and things they support, the things that they don't support. But that's where we start, because that's where, that's kind of where we've been living. I think it's on us to help shift those learning management systems. And I think in general, that's what we would be doing then with HyFlex, is as the environment shift. We didn't go out and look for a new platform, in part because the challenge for getting faculty to just even think about teaching differently like this, because it is a, it's a radical change. They no longer will control who's in their classroom. They'll know who's in their class, and they'll be able to control what they're doing online or face-to-face, right? So there's those control issues. But the students have a lot more freedom just being able to choose which way they're coming. So to put them into another environment was beyond what we intended to do. So we have not done that. That does. There may be some others who have done that in their own implementations.
We do have another question with regards to the focus on educators by Carmine Maiello. What is the best approach, in your opinion, with reference to students' achievement, engagement, and learning?
Yeah, well, what I try to do, and I help faculty when I'm talking with them, is we look at what's working now in classes, and it may be our own classes. So we start with what we're doing in the classroom. What do you do to engage students in the classroom? Are there ways to do that similar engagement in the online environment? Is it through the questioning? Is it through the activities? Is it through interesting ways of doing discussions, debates, role plays, things like that, things that students will find some value in doing? They have to see the direct connection. If we just kind of toss them out into the content world and say, you know, read this and post your best ideas on, you know, this article or this other kind of thing, that's not going to be engaging, even for graduate students who are engaged or who are invested in the content. That's not often very engaging. So we have to find ways to do that. There are a lot of good, effective practices out there for creating engaging online discussions and doing a more an engaging kind of synchronous environment as well. One of the challenges is synchronous engagement has to work side by side with classroom engagement. And there, the best approach I've found is when I treat all of those students the same, but I specifically keep track of how I'm engaging with the online students as well, because they're easy to forget if they're just little boxes on a screen, even if that screen is up on the front of the room. So the approaches that work well in synchronous education and in asynchronous education in the classroom will work well in HyFlex. The challenge will be to find a mix that a single faculty or maybe with a TA support can manage. I also recruit students in my class to support the synchronous connected students in the engagement through chat and other technologies while they're in the classroom. I always have students who have devices in the classroom, and I'll keep them actively engaged as well, and kind of recruit them as unofficial TAs for that aspect of the course. That's worked very well.
Natalie Koppitz asks, how was the acceptance to this strategic shift from the teacher's perspective?
Yes, well, pre-COVID, this was almost always, or at least more than half the time, it was a grassroots effort by teachers, by faculty who wanted to teach differently because they saw the need from their students, or they wanted to have more students from different areas in their courses, partly because they needed enrollment or they wanted to support retention, or they just wanted to serve students better. And so in those days, it wasn't hard because they were taking this on themselves. Now, as some schools started administratively making the system move this way, now it starts becoming a top-down approach. And in those cases, it the way they have seemed to have been done successfully was really a multi-year process where the administration comes up with a strategic initiative that then they get the faculty buy-in, often through a senate or something like that. And then they develop pilot programs, and then they develop the resources to support the faculty in learning how to do it. They equip the classrooms with the technology they need. And so it might take 3 years to do a substantial rollout of a HyFlex program when it's a college or department or a university kind of initiative. But when it's coming from the faculty, faculty are very creative in ways of making this work when they really are invested into it. This day and age, now we're finding a lot more schools, especially at all level, four-year universities, community colleges, even K-12 high schools or K-12 schools have made a decision. Okay, we want students in the classroom, but we know we can only put half of them there. So now we're going to do both. So we're kind of forcing ourselves and calling it HyFlex, even if there's not really any flexibility among students. This is where we're seeing a lot more reaction from teachers saying, hey, wait a minute. I don't have the resource to do this. We're not equipped to do this. I don't know how to do this. Basically, this is not my idea, and it's going to be a lot more work for me. So in those cases, we're seeing a lot of pushback. And so the challenge is really to kind of help students or faculty kind of ease into the design Find ways to help them kind of maybe take some things off of their requirements as far as the time required for you know, other kinds of administrative functions at the school, so they have more time to prepare and to teach these classes, as well as to perhaps reduce the time spent in the classroom so that they have more time to learn how and to actually facilitate students in the online environment. I know a lot of K-12 student teachers who teach 5 days a week, and it's hard, it's almost impossible for them to do this well. Many of them do it well, of course. But some of those districts are finally changing their approach. They say, well, you need more time to prepare for this, obviously. So they're going to like a 3 day a week teaching, like a Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and having Tuesday, Thursdays for preparation. That's something that is a reasonable compromise that will give teachers more time to prepare. So if you give these teachers time to prepare and they see that it's really serving students better, almost all of them will do this gladly, or at least not grudgingly, because they care about student learning. But that has to be clear to them. They can't just see it as an administrative mandate, for numbers that don't matter to the teachers.
I'm afraid we are running out of time indeed. One quick last question with maybe a swift answer, because I do like the shift of focus in the end back to the students. Do any elements of HyFlex translate into the campus experience that takes place outside of the classroom?
Yes, I think one of the things we get is an appreciation for the fact that a lot of student learning happens outside of the classroom, whether it's a HyFlex class or not. As a faculty member, we could get really focused on the classroom, and what I'm saying in the classroom and what you're saying back to me as being the center of learning. When in actuality, much of the learning, at least most of it, happens outside of class. And that doesn't have to be online. It just is outside of the classroom environment. So yeah, I think that is a very true thing going on. And so that can help too. And the other thing we're finding is that when I have students engaging in other things that have always been co-located on campus, we're learning now how we can do some of those virtually. I think that's another thing that we're going to continue to allow students to engage in those kinds of activities, even if they can't presently be there in person.
Thank you very much, Professor Billy, indeed, for your inspirational keynote talk and for providing us with all these answers.